In my previous lecture, I discussed poliovirus with you. And if you remember, I told you that it belongs to the family of picornaviruses, and they are RNA non-enveloped viruses with single-stranded RNA genome. And then I told you what polio is, and as I said, it's a very contagious, irreversible, crippling disease, mainly seen in children. In most part of the world, it has been eradicated by vaccines, but it is still present as endemic in Pakistan. It is transmitted by a fecal-oral route, especially by drinking contaminated water, and it goes and infects the neurons of the CNS, resulting in various clinical manifestations, the most important being the non-paralytic polio infection or the spinal or bulbar poliomyelitis. We have discussed this in detail in the previous lecture. So today I am going to move on to the diagnosis and treatment of this disease. The diagnosis is dependent on virus isolation, serological testing, and CSF analysis. CSF analysis is done to find out the number of cells, whether they are increased or decreased. In this case, the cells are markedly increased, and when DLC is done, the cells are mostly lymphocytes. On chemistry of CSF, the proteins are mildly elevated. Serological tests are important, because a four-fold titer rise between the acute and the convalescent phase always indicates poliovirus infection. Now, for isolation of viruses, the specimens which are mainly used are the throat swabs, rectal swab, or stool specimens. And these specimens are transported in frozen containers to the laboratory, special laboratories, where they are introduced to various cell lines. The specimens are introduced to human or monkey cells. The viruses from this specimen gets attached into to the cell receptors, and they then get into the cell and start replicating over there. As they replicate, they produce effect which is known as cytopathic effect. Besides this, direct demonstration of the virus can be seen or can be done by electron microscopy or by using immune electron microscopy on stool specimens. Isolation is done on cell cultures, and the most commonly used cell culture is HEP2. This is human epithelial cell lines, which are made from laryngeal carcinoma. Now, the viruses, as I said, are going to get attached to the specific receptors present on the cell. Then they penetrate and they start multiplying within the cell, and that's lead to formation of the cytopathic effect. The cytopathic effects are basically the area where the virus is replicating, and you can identify this cytopathic effect within the cells, as you can see over here. This, in case of poliovirus, they are going to produce rounded infected. These are rounded infected pycnotic eosinophilic intranuclear inclusions are seen. So this is specific for poliovirus, eosinophilic intranuclear inclusions, and this is going to constitute one of your examination MCQs. And within the cell cultures, we can identify them by performing neutralization tests and using specific antiseras, or we can also use ELISA test. I am not going to go into the details, because as I have been saying, we have already done this in my previous lectures. Serological tests, paired seras are taken, one in the acute phase and the second in the convalescent phase, and there should be a four-fold rise in the titer. And because the intestinal IgA and humoral IgG both appear early in the life, early in the infection, so it is very important, they're going to persist for life. So it is very important to see a four-fold rise in the titers. Now, next I am going to move on to the vaccines, polio vaccines. Both oral and live attenuated polio vaccines are used worldwide. And the oral polio vaccine has been the vaccine of choice for eradicating this polio infection globally, because of the fact that it can be easily administered. Secondly, Once it is administered, it is going to cause intestinal immunity, and it is cost effective. The only rare side effect which is seen The only rare side effect which is seen with this vaccine is paralytic poliomyelitis, and it is seen 2.4 million doses. Now, WHO has recommended that OPV, which is oral polio vaccine, should remain the vaccine of choice for a routine infant immunization. And in most of the country, this is what is seen, but it should include one inactivated polio vaccine dose to the schedule. In polio endemic areas like Pakistan or India or like Afghanistan, WHO also has recommended a zero dose, which should be given at birth, and this should be followed by the primary series of 3 OPVs and at least one inactivated polio vaccine, which is given by intramuscular injection. Now, before I move on to these vaccines, let's go back to this slide: passive immunization and active immunization. When we talk about vaccination, we talk about passive immunization or active. Passive is that if an unimmunized or a non-immunized person is exposed to some disease, then immunoglobulins are injected in that person, and these immunoglobulins are going to give protection for a short period of time till the patient starts producing his own immunoglobulin. This is passive protection or passive immunoglobulins, when human immunoglobulins are injected to protect a non-immunized person from a disease, and that person has been exposed to that disease. And then we have active immunization. Active immunization is then when the person start producing his own humoral antibodies, which are going to neutralize the pathogen responsible for infection, and hence it is going to prevent infection. For example, like hepatitis B surface antigen, which is given as an active immunizing agent to the patient, and the patient is then protected from hepatitis B viral infection. All right, so talking about the polio vaccines, as I said, they can be oral polio vaccine or it can be inactivated polio vaccine. Now, the oral polio vaccine, is the other name for this is Sabin vaccine, and these are live attenuated vaccines. And if this vaccine is given early in lifetime, it is going to prevent the flaccid paralysis which are associated with this virus. The primary schedule for oral polio vaccine, as I said, this is WHO has recommended that this should be the vaccine of choice for routine immunization. 4 doses are given at the age of 2 months, 4 months, 6 months and 18 months, and then a booster dose is given at 4 years. The inactivated or killed vaccine, the other name for this is Sark vaccine, and it is IPV. IPV stands for inactivated polio vaccine. So the 4 dose IP schedule is a primary series of 3 IPV doses are given at 6 weeks, 10 weeks or 14 weeks, and then a booster dose can be given at 6 months. Now, this is injected intramuscular in the form of intramuscular injections. Oral or Sabin vaccine is live attenuated strain. All the 3 strains are utilized, and it is going to, because it is given orally, so it goes in the intestines and it is going to produce IgA immunoglobulin, and that is going to give intestinal immunity, and then it goes into the bloodstream and it is going to give us systemic immunity in the form of IgG immunoglobulin. However, the only disadvantage is because it is live vaccine, it can revert back to its virulent form, and as I've just told you that very rare, this condition is very rare, but still 1 in 2.4 million doses can result in this virulent form. Then we have inactivated or Sark vaccine, and this is the inactivated polio virus, and this is IPV. Now, the polio viruses are grown in cell culture and tissue cultures or cell cultures. They are either killed or they are formally inactivated. When they are inactivated, then they are used in the form of injection, and all the 3 serotypes are used in this injection. But because it is given in this injection form, it is only going to produce IgG immunoglobulin or systemic immunity. No intestinal immunity is seen in this case because it does not go in the intestines. So the immunity is to be maintained by repeated booster. But the advantage here is that it cannot revert back to its virulent form. What are the disadvantages of live or Sabin vaccine? This is the oral vaccine. As I've been telling you that it can revert back to live form, and especially this type 3 polio virus is notorious for getting back into the, or reverting back into the virulent form, and it can cause this paralytic poliomyelitis. Secondly, we cannot give this in patients who are immunodeficient or immunocompromised, because again, it can cause disease in these patients. Limited replication occurs if there is a pre-existing enterovirus GIT infection. If the GIT infection is already infected with some other virus, then the replication of this virus does not take place. It must be kept in fridge because it is heat inactivated. All right, so next, I'm going to move on to one of your, again, examination question. Enumerate the important features of polio virus vaccines. Now, the polio virus vaccines is the killed vaccine or the live vaccine, which is the Sabin vaccine. At times, the examiner is not going to tell you whether they are killed or live. They are going to use this term, soft vaccine or Sabin vaccine. Now, both of these, prevention of disease is in both the cases. Both the vaccines are going to prevent the disease. Interrupt transmission is only seen by Sabin because this is the oral vaccine and it is taken into the intestine and transmission occurs from intestines. However, this killed vaccine or the Sark vaccine is not going to interrupt the transmission. IgG immunoglobulin is produced by both these vaccines. However, IgG is produced only when it is taken orally in the intestine, and that is by live or the Sabin vaccine. Interfere with replication of virulent virus in the gut is seen again with the live vaccine, which goes into the gut. However, revert back to virulence is again this live vaccine, it can revert back to its virulent form and can cause paralytic poliomyelitis. Co-infection, if there is co-infection in the intestine, it is again going to affect the live vaccine the function, but not that of the killed vaccine. Route of administration, the killed vaccine or the Sark vaccine is injected, whereas the live vaccine is given orally. Hence, the duration of immunity with live is longer. It is going to give you intestinal immunity as well as humoral immunity, whereas the Sark vaccine is just going to give you humoral immunity. All right. When we talk about immunity, the next important thing is herd immunity. You are asked about this in your Viva, and you can even get a part of the SEQ on herd immunity. Now, what is herd immunity? Herd immunity is also known as community immunity, and this is protection of an unimmunized individual from infection when a large population of that community is already immunized, and that is the large population is the herd. In other words, if a large number of people in a community are immunized, then the small number of people which are left behind will be protected, and that is known as herd immunity. And I am going to discuss this in the next slide with a diagram, and it will make things easier for you. Now, for herd immunity to occur, the vaccine must prevent transmission of the virus, and at the same time, it should prevent disease production. Transmission and disease production both should be prevented for herd immunity. Now, this is a diagram which is very clearly telling you what herd immunity is. Now, if you look at this blue people, the blue are the non-immunized healthy people. The yellow are the immunized and healthy people, whereas the red are the sick people who are contagious. In a community, this is a community where you see all the blue people, which means that they are all non-immunized, and you see these two red people who are the sick people and they have a contagious disease. So they are capable of spreading the disease throughout the population, and after some time, as you can see over here, everyone has acquired the disease, that contagious disease, except for a few people. Next is, some of the population gets immunized, as you see this yellow one. This is a population where some of them have got immunized, but the two sick contagious patients are still there, and they are still capable of spreading this disease through the some of this population. As you can see over here, the population is being infected by the red infected contagious people, and they have a contagious disease which they are spreading to all. And you can see the yellow ones which are still there, and they are the ones who have been immunized and they are healthy. Now the third group of population is the one where you see that the majority of the population is immunized. The two sick people with contagious disease is they are still there, but the spread of the infection is now contained, and this is because the people who are immunized are going to protect the rest of the people, the unimmunized people, from getting this infection, and this is known as herd immunity. So herd immunity is when majority of the population is immunized and the disease is contained, as a result of which the remaining unimmunized people will not catch the disease. They are being protected by the herd. So this is herd immunity. If I go back to my first slide again, you will now understand what herd immunity is. This is protection of unimmunized individual from an infection when a sufficiently large population has been immunized. And this large population is known as herd, and this is herd immunization. Now, keeping this in mind, let's move on to the polio vaccines. The herd immunity in polio is given by the live attenuated polio vaccine. It gives a very good herd immunity because it produces both intestinal IgA, which is going to prevent the polio from replicating in the GIT, so it is going to prevent transmission, and secondly it is going to form humoral IgG, which is going to prevent disease production. So herd immunity, a vaccine which is preventing transmission and of the disease and preventing disease production, is the one which is going to give you a good herd immunity. So in other words, the live attenuated polio vaccine is going to give us a good herd immunity as compared to the inactivated polio vaccine that does not induce herd immunity, because the people who are immunized, although they are protected by IgG, but they can still serve as a source of polio for others because secretory IgA is not produced. The virus goes into the intestine and it is still capable of producing disease in that, is still capable of transmission of this virus. And only when the patient produces its IgG, only then it can prevent the disease production, but transmission is not prevented. So inactivated polio is injected, it is producing IgG, but it is not preventing the transmission of this virus because secretory IgA is not produced. So this is herd immunity. You are asked about in your exams, in your table Viva Plus, you can get an SEQ on herd immunity. Next, I'm moving on to your assignment. You have to mark your attendance by sending the solved MCQs today and send the SEQs in the group or email them within 3 days of this lecture. Now, there are two MCQs. One is live attenuated vaccine and inactivated are both available. In which of the following situation is OPV preferred? And second, picornavirus vaccine has been used for several decades in prevention of human disease. Which of the following statement is correct? Go through all the statements and then come up with the correct answer. All right, this is the SEQ which you have to send by email, or you can just put it there on the on WhatsApp group. An outbreak of polio is suspected in a remote village of Sawar. Discuss the pathogenesis and clinical manifestations of the disease. What is post polio syndrome? Give the laboratory diagnosis of this polio virus and tabulate the important features of two types of vaccines available against polio. So with this, we are done with polio, and next I move on to the next virus. Thank you.